I think after you hear Judy speak tonight, you want to know more. So you'll have to read her essay on Ellis Island, and it's actually going to be called Journey to the West, Chinese Detainees on Angel Island, and also a very in-depth interview with her done by Dr. Shanda Xing from Taiwan, and that will also be in the next issue, actually. So just a plug for, you know, the CUNY Forum. It's really a pleasure and a delight personally as well, because Judy and I go way back. We're both from Chinatown, and I think we first met in the Chinatown Library, because Judy was the first Chinese librarian at the Chinatown Library. It's kind of odd that the Chinatown Library did not have a Chinese librarian, but Judy was the first Chinese American librarian and helped to develop the first collection on Chinese language materials for the Chinatown Library, and later on for other libraries in the Bay Area. I'm going to kind of introduce Judy more formally, but before I do, I just wanted to say that most of what we know in Asian American history or Chinese American history is actually done by guys, by men. Very few women historians. And I think a woman historian tells history differently. You know, it's sort of like men always talk about wars and soldiers going to war, but what about all the women at home? And you know, a lot of we always hear about immigrants, Chinese immigration, about the men who went overseas and so forth, but what about the women? So Judy is very special, very rare, and has done so much for Chinese American and Asian American history. And so I'm gonna just kind of read off this piece of paper. Judy Jung, Professor Emerita, she's a second generation Chinese American, born and raised in San Francisco, Chinatown, the other part of China, the other part of America. She received her BA in English Literature and Chinese Language from SF State, and her Master's in Library Science, and her PhD in Ethnic Studies from the University of California, Berkeley. Judy's worked as a public librarian and a journalist at East-West before becoming Professor of American Studies at the University of California, Santa Cruz. You know, Judy's a pioneer in terms of women's history as well as immigration history, and her publications include Island, Poetry and History of Chinese Immigrants on Angel Island, Unbound Feet, A Social History of Chinese Women in San Francisco, and Chinese American Voices from the Gold Rush to the Present, and The Adventures of Eddie Fong, Chinatown Kid, Texas Cowboy, Prisoner of War, and Angel Island, Immigrant Gateway to America. Judy has also was instrumental in helping to make sure that our San Francisco Chinatown Library was recently renamed the Himmark Lai Library after the notable historian Himmark Lai. And as you see from the cover of the second edition of Island, Island is one of the seminal books in Chinese American history, edited by Himmark Lai, Jenny Lim, and Judy Jung. Judy also was a major editor for Himmark Lai's posthumous autobiography, published a couple of years ago, right? 2 years ago? And we worked on it along with Ruth Ann McCunn. Judy has won many awards and so forth. And I wanted to, before Judy comes on, I just wanted to quote something which she said in an interview, the recent interview, which you'll be able to read. Can I quote from you? This is from Judy Jung. She's talking about the process of doing oral history. And she says, I am firmly convinced that everyone's history is important, regardless of whether I'm interviewing male or female immigrants, rich or poor. It is their history. So let them tell it the way they want to tell it. Put it in their words. Don't redress it. Don't disguise it. Don't improve on it. Don't try to put words into their mouths. And this is from the interview, which is forthcoming. I think Judy can speak for herself, so I should just be quiet. And let's all give Judy Yong, Professor Emeritus, historian, pioneer of Asian American women's history, a big hand. Thank you, Judy.
Thank you, Rustin. Thank you, Asian American Research Institute, for inviting me to come tonight and speak about my new research and book about Angel Island, the Chinese immigration and poetry. And in addition to that, I've done additional research about Chinese poetry and immigration at Ellis Island that I'll share with you as well. So let me start by talking a little bit about how I began working on this topic and the research that went into the first edition and then into the second edition of Island, Poetry and History of Chinese Immigrants on Angel Island. I have to go back 40 years to 1975, and there I am on the far on your far left. The three of us, myself, I was a librarian at that time, and him, Mark Lai, that Russ mentioned, he's the Dean of Chinese American History. He was at that time an engineer and had not even started publishing books on Chinese American history. And Jenny Lim on the far right, she was already an accomplished poet and playwright. So the three of us are we're all descendants of Angel Island detainees. We're all second generation Chinese Americans. And when the three of us heard about the discovery of Chinese poems carved into the walls of this Angel Island immigration station that we had not known about, even though our parents had been detained there and had spent time there. But when we heard about the poems and we went and saw for ourselves the evidence and the parting comments and just the moving, poignant poems expressing so much anger and frustration and despair about being locked up and being discriminated against by harsh immigration laws at this place called Angel Island. We joined efforts with other Asian American community activists because the state, California State Parks, which had taken over the immigration site after the immigration station moved back to San Francisco in 1940. In any case, they were going to tear down the building, and we were really concerned about losing the poems, losing the history, and losing this place that says so much about the beginnings of Chinese immigration to this country. So that we decided, the three of us, that what we would do to help save the poems and save the site would be to write a book. We would collect as many poems as we can find, translate them into English, and we would interview, because there's so little written about this topic, this is where I learned to do oral history, we would interview anyone who would be willing to talk to us about what happened to them when they were detained at Angel Island. So our parents, beginning with our parents. And we decided that we would then write a book about this history, and that would also record in English as well as Chinese the poems. So that was our goal, our mission as a team. And when we began looking for people to interview, we ended up interviewing about 40 people before the book was published. And it was really, really difficult to find people who were willing to talk to us, because so many of them are basically, so many of them are illegal immigrants coming in fraudulently as paper sons or paper daughters. So no one wanted him to talk about that. And they certainly didn't want to recall the terrible experience they had at Angel Island. So it was really hard. We started with our own family and then our relatives and then the relatives of our friends, and eventually we ended up interviewing about 40 people who were detainees, but also people who had worked at Angel Island as interpreters and as inspectors. We wanted to get their point of view about what happened at Angel Island as well. But in the process of looking for people, two of the people we interviewed was Ted Yee and Smiley Jan, and they were both detained at Angel Island in the 1930s, and they took the trouble of copying down into notebooks every poem that they saw on the walls of the men's dormitory, hundreds of poems. And each of them, independent of each other, they were there at different times, copied down close to 100 poems into notebooks. Now, the poems, you can barely make out the poems today. It's been obliterated and defaced, and so it's very hard to find complete poems that you can really read. So fortunately, they copied down the poems in the 1930s, and it's their collection of poems. We ended up with 135 poems. We found poems off the wall that they had not recorded, and we found poems published in newspapers too. So we ended up with 135 poems in our book, thanks to their foresight to copy down the poems and keep those notebooks and to share it with us. They understood the importance of these poems. So the poems, along with the 40 oral history interviews, form the primary sources for the first edition of Island. When we finished doing our research and writing the book, we did it in 3 years, part-time, while we were all working full-time at our jobs. When we finished the book in 1980, we couldn't find a publisher who would publish it. Because at that time, publishers really didn't think there was a market for Chinese American history, Chinese American literature, certainly not a bilingual collection of Chinese American poems. So we fundraised and we self-published. Now everyone self-publishes and it's easy to do, but this is in 1980. And so we wanted to get the book out, so we didn't get discouraged. We just did it on our own with the help of the Chinese Culture Center and the San Francisco Study Center. And since the book's been published, it's remained in print. It's become a staple in Asian American literature and American literature classes throughout the country. And a lot of more new research have been done on the poetry as well as on the history and on the experience of immigrants at Angel Island. So much that we began to think a year ago that it was time to do a new edition, an expanded edition, updated edition of this book. And by then, Himark Lai, unfortunately was not around to help us with the second edition. He died in 2009. But before he died, I had a conversation with him, and I asked him if he thought it would be a good idea to revise the book, and he said yes. And I said, what changes would you like to see made? And he said two things. One, he said, is combine the main text poems with the appendix poems into one sequence of poems, because in the first edition we have 69 poems in the main text, and then we have the remainder poems in the back in smaller print, the appendix. So we did do that with the new edition. The other thing he said is, remember all those poems that were discovered at Ellis Island and also at Victoria, BC, at the immigration stations there? Well, go and you'll find them in my collection, his archives, his complete library collection has been donated to the UC Berkeley Ethnic Studies Library. So he says, go to the Ethnic Studies Library and you'll find it in this folder marked Ellis Island and Angel Island, and then include those poems in the revised edition of the book. So for the second edition of Island, which was just published in November of last year, we expanded the historical introduction with a lot of new information from the research, and we added the new poems that had been found at Ellis Island. There are four that we added, and then there were 9 poems from Victoria that we added to this book. And then, being an oral historian, I was never happy with the first edition's excerpting oral histories and not providing the full stories. So I wrote up 20 profiles of the interviews that we did in the 1970s. So there are 20 full stories of former detainees and workers at Angel Island in this book. And we're able to also include over 100 photographs. The first edition only had 22 photographs. And one of the things we were able to do now, when we did the first edition, is people that we interviewed, we promised them that we would not use their real names, and we, of course, would not be able to use their pictures, because they were always afraid of getting in trouble. And so we honor that by using pseudonyms in the first edition and not using their photos. But with this edition, except for two people, everyone else has passed on. And we got permission from their families to let us use their real names and let us update their stories, and then also they gave us photographs. So that, combined with many historical photos that we've uncovered of the Indrani Immigration Station, form the 100 photographs that are in this new edition. So, for those of you who are not familiar with the history of the Angel Island Immigration Station, it was built in 1910 to process new immigrants coming from across the Pacific to this country. And it remained on Angel Island until 1940, when a fire burnt down the administration building, and they moved the immigration station back to San Francisco. So this is a picture of the immigration station in 1910. And there's a pier here that's not there anymore if you go today, because that pier has been destroyed. But the pier, the people would, they would take a ferry from San Francisco across the bay, and the ferry would dock at the end of the pier, and people would walk up the pier and into the building here. This is the administration building that was burnt. It's no longer there now. And this is where they're processed. That's where all the offices are, and that's where the interrogation rooms are. And on the top floor is where they had dormitories for European immigrants and all women. And then this building here is still there. It's the hospital. So there was an immigration hospital at Angel Island. And then the building here, this is the detention barracks where the Chinese men were kept. And that's where most of the poems were. In fact, that was almost all the poems were there. We found some poems in the hospital as well, because the building burned, and the women were kept there. We did not recover any of the poems written by Chinese women. And we know that they told us there were poems in the women's lavatory written in Chinese by women. So, but the building burned. And then the other buildings here, these cottages are for the staff. They lived on Angel Island, families, and the Chinese kitchen helpers and the cooks also lived there. And these cottages actually were designed by Julia Morgan, a very famous California architect. But those cottages were also destroyed. So today, what you will see if you go to Angel Island is this: immigration barracks for the Chinese men have been totally renovated and made into a museum, and the poetry has been preserved on the walls with interpretations. And the Angel Island Immigration Station Foundation now is working on fundraising to convert the hospital building into a house museum, as well as a conference center. So that's where that with saving and restoring the history and the site. Okay. So from the very beginning, when they built the Angel Island Immigration Station in 1910, they dubbed they had a popular name for the station. They called it the Ellis Island of the West. I'm sure you've heard that. And to this day, that name still sticks. But I would argue that Angel Island Immigration Station was very different from the Ellis Island Immigration Station. The Ellis Island Immigration Station was built in 1892 to welcome European immigrants and to enforce immigration laws that restricted but did not exclude immigrants. And until it closed in 1954, over 12 million immigrants were processed through Ellis Island, usually within 5 hours. They were given a cursory line inspection as a physical exam, and they were asked usually about 30 questions, the same questions on the manifest, to make sure they were of sound mind and sound body. And only about 1% in the end were deported, denied entry and deported from Ellis Island. So the overwhelming majority of the 12 million went on to become U.S. citizens and to realize the American dream. But in contrast, when we think about what happened at Angel Island, that being the main gateway for Chinese and Asian immigrants, it was really built in 1910 to better enforce the Chinese Exclusion Act and other anti-Asian laws to keep Asians and Chinese out of this country. The Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882 specifically barred Chinese laborers from coming to this country, and it also denied Chinese aliens who are already here the right to become U.S. citizens. They could not naturalize until 1943 when the Exclusion Act was repealed. It should be pointed out that this Exclusion Act was passed in 1882 at the height of the anti-Chinese movement, and is due to pressure from, in 1870s were really hard times, economic recessions, and white workers, trade unions, and opportunistic politicians were blaming the Chinese workers for lowering wages, for taking away jobs, for not assimilating into our society, the mainstream society, and for being a threat to the American way of life. And they pressured Congress then in 1882 to pass this law to stop further immigration. And it's the first time that the U.S. passed a law against a group coming to this country on the basis of their race and national origin. It was against the Chinese specifically. It marked the end of open immigration, because before 1882, people can just come and go, and there was no even any interrogation or immigration process. So it marked the end of that kind of open immigration, regardless of where you came from, and the beginning of restrictive immigration, because in subsequent years after 1882, other laws were passed to exclude Asian immigrants, like the Japanese and the Koreans and the Asian Indians or South Asians and the Filipinos in 1934. And actually in 1924, there was the Immigration Act that restricted immigration from Southern Eastern European countries to stop immigration from Italy and from Spain, and to stop the Jews from coming and the Poles and the Slavs. So in 1924, it was beginning of restriction of European immigrants as well. But it started with the 1882 Act. So at Angel Island, Chinese immigrants in particular then were thoroughly examined and interrogated. And they were detained for weeks and months at a time, compared to the European experience at Ellis Island. Now, I want you to appreciate this. It's a lot of painstaking research to come up with these statistics, and even then, these are only estimates, because so much of the records were burnt in the administration building when Angel Island, when they had the fire there in 1940, but it also because the Immigration Department did not keep good statistics every year. In fact, after 1924, they stopped keeping statistics, specific statistics on Chinese immigration. So these statistics we got from going through all the annual reports and also looking at a lot of microfilmed registers of applicants coming through Angel Island. And so we can say with certainty now that approximately 1 million immigrants were processed through Angel Island, compared to 12 million at Ellis Island. And of that 1 million, about half of them, 500,000, were actually detained at Angel Island during the time that the immigration station was there from 1910 to 1940. And that's because not everyone who comes on a ship and arrives in San Francisco gets sent to Angel Island. If you came first class, you were usually just interviewed on board the the ship and allowed to land. If you were returning from a visit to China, you're Chinese, and you went to China for a visit and you're coming back and you have documentation to prove that you you had been a legal resident, then you were not, you didn't have to go to Andrew Island and be go through this whole interrogation process a second time. So as a result, we know then among the largest groups then, about 50,000 Chinese and versus 85,000 Japanese, 8,000 South Asians are mainly from India, and at that time Sikhs, 8,000 Russians and Jews who crossed the, went east across Siberia to Japan and caught a ship there. Many of them were refugees and crossed the Pacific and ended up in San Francisco and Angel Island. And 1,000 Koreans and 1,000 Filipinos. Those are our best estimates. And also based on our research, we know then that that the inspectors actually at Angel Island rejected about 10% of all Chinese applicants, denied them entry for one reason or another. And that of the ones who were rejected, 88% retained attorneys to appeal the case to fight exclusion. And when they did that, over 55% won their appeals and were admitted into the country. So, but because of this long, arduous process for Chinese immigrants, particularly if they have to appeal their case and stay locked up on Angel Island until the case had been settled, we counted about 6,000 Chinese who spent more than 1 year detained at Angel Island. And the Chinese understood that if they would invest more money to hire a lawyer to appeal their cases, and if they're willing to spend more time locked up at Angel Island for the waiting for the appeal case to go through, in most cases that they would win their appeals and be admitted. So that's why such a high percentage of them took this route to fight exclusion. In comparison, the Japanese and European immigrants at Angel Island had the lowest deportation rate. In the end, Chinese only had 5%. Only 5% of the Chinese were deported if they went through the appeal process. But compared to 1% at Ellis Island and compared to 1% of the Europeans and Japanese who also were processed to Angel Island. The highest rate, the highest deportation rate was not the Chinese. The highest deportation rate was among South Asians, those from India. 25% of them were deported compared to 5% for the Chinese. Now, why was that the case? In the case of Japan, this is where nationality and foreign relations makes a big difference in your fate when you arrive here. Who ends up going to Angel Island, how long they're going to be detained there, and how they are treated at Angel Island, a lot of that depends on your race, on your nationality, on your class, or on your gender, okay? So for the Japanese, because Japan at the time was a rising military power, it was able to negotiate a gentleman's agreement with the US government to allow Japan to regulate immigration. This was to forestall the passage of a Japanese Exclusion Act. And the gentleman's agreement then let Japan stopped the further immigration of Japanese laborers to this country. And the gentleman's agreement also said that Japanese laborers and aliens here could send for their wives and send for their children. The Chinese Exclusion Act specifically said Chinese laborers could not send for their women, their wives, and could not send for their children. So that was the big difference, and that's why the population as well as the family numbers are much larger among Japanese Americans than among the Chinese American population. So because of this agreement then, the process is very different for Japanese coming. The overwhelming majority coming through Angel Island, and they all had to go to Angel Island for a physical exam, and that included among the 85,000 Japanese, included 10,000 picture brides who were coming to join their husbands, many of them who they had never met. They just had a picture to show who they are, but they had been formally married and put in the family register. And the U.S. government recognized this as legitimate marriage. So the Japanese and the men and the women who came through Angel Island spent no more than 1 to 2 days at Angel Island. Once they passed the physical examination and they were subject to a brief interview, then they were allowed to land and be released from Angel Island to go on to San Francisco. And the high deportation rate for South Asians was because at the time that they began coming, 1908 until about 1917, there's an Immigration Act that specifically barred South Asians from immigrating to this country. But before 1917, immigration inspectors, with pressure from the Asiatic Exclusion League, wanted to stop South Asians and Asian Indians from coming into this country, and they used two excuses to do that. One is if they could find that they had any kind of parasitic worms, they were found with hookworm or liver fluke worm, and many Asians, you know, would have this because if they come from rural parts of Asia, more than likely they would have these parasitic worms in them, among all the groups. So if they were found with that, then that would be a reason to deport them and not admit them in the country. The other reason they used was called likely to become public charges. That is, anyone who comes and is considered poor and does not have anyone here to help them get settled, find work, and help support them, or, you know, be difficult for them to find jobs. So they had an argument that said, you know, even you're coming, you're poor, you're a laborer, there aren't going to be any jobs for you at this time, so you're likely to become a public charge. And those were the two reasons they used. And unlike the Chinese, the South Asians did not have the same kinds of financial resources or community organizations to support them in their appeals. So they didn't fight back to the legal system. And unlike the Japanese, they didn't have a strong home government to fight for them and to protect their interests and to defend their rights. At the time, India was under British colonialism. And if anything else, Britain didn't even want them to leave and go abroad because they were afraid that, and it was true that many of the Sikhs and South Asians coming at this time, particularly among those who were claiming to be students, that they were part of the Garter Party and the National Independence Movement to overthrow British rule in India. So in any case, for those two reasons, then Asian Indians were deported in droves compared to all the other groups. And after 1917, they stopped coming because of the Immigration Act of 1917 that I mentioned. So, just like at Ellis Island, immigrants coming through Angel Island had to go through a physical examination. And all of them, regardless of their race or ethnicity, were subjected to a line inspection like at Ellis Island. And they all had to go through this eye exam with the hook to look for trachoma and also other kinds of eye infections that are considered contagious. But for the Chinese in particular, there was an additional hurdle in terms of passing the physical examination. Actually, because scientists at this time believed that Asians were coming with certain kinds of contagious diseases that would be detrimental to white Americans, such as those parasitic diseases, the hookworms, and cholera, and certain things that they thought originated in Asia. Because they suspected they were carrying these kinds of diseases, they subjected them to this very invasive examination of their stools and of their blood to look for traces of parasitic diseases. All the Asians, not just the Chinese, but Europeans were not subjected to that same exam. So that was an additional ordeal for Chinese and Asians coming through Angel Island. I found that at Ellis Island, that the Chinese who were processed to Ellis Island, and I estimated there were about 5,000 between 1910 and 1930, 5,000 compared to 100,000 of Chinese at Angel Island, that the Chinese at Ellis Island were not subjected to the stool and blood examination for hookworms. And I think it's because there were fewer Chinese and they didn't want to bother with the exam, but also because they believed that many of the Chinese were immigrating from Europe, Cuba, Trinidad, and Mexico, and they were higher class immigrants. They were either diplomats or business people, merchants, or students. So they didn't think that they would have these kinds of parasitic diseases compared to those coming from the rural parts of Asia. So in any case, the physical exam was easier at Ellis Island than it was at Angel Island for the Chinese. But regardless of which port of entry the Chinese came through, and there were 24 ports of entry at the time that Angel Island opened in 1910, the Chinese were always subjected to this special interrogation process that was created by immigration officials who knew that they were probably coming in fraudulently to circumvent Exclusion Act. They were coming in with false identities, claiming to be the children or the spouses of exempt classes of Chinese immigrants. Because the Chinese Exclusion Act said laborers could not come, but it still allowed merchants, diplomats, students and teachers, and tourists, and anyone who was a U.S. citizen or related to U.S. citizen, those people can still come. So the Chinese did figure a way, a very complicated process of using immigration brokers to buy and sell immigration documents and identities for these exempt classes. And as you know, one of the things that helped the situation was in 1906, there was an earthquake and fire in San Francisco. It destroyed all the birth certificates. And so anyone who claimed to be born in San Francisco and would be a U.S. citizen was believed. And so many people used that to claim U.S. citizenship and then to say that they had so many sons and a wife in China that they would like to sponsor and come to this country. So that just created an opportunity to create more slots that can be sold to fellow villagers so that they can immigrate during the exclusion period. So because the immigration authorities knew that this was probably what was going on, and they were right, about 80 to 90% of Chinese who immigrated during the exclusion era from 1882 to 1943, 80 to 90% were paper sons, paper daughters, paper wives. They were illegal immigrants. And so they've devised this system of interrogating the applicant and asking the person very detailed questions about their family history, about the village where they came from, about their relationship to their witnesses, and the answers would be compared to the answers of their witnesses who were asked the same questions. And if there were discrepancies between their answers, that would be cause for deportation, to be denied admittance, and to be deported. So you take the example of this case, which I found at the New York archives, of Chen Yufeng. He was a 14-year-old son of a U.S. citizen, he claimed, and he immigrated to New York to join his father and brother in 1936. And because he claimed that his father was a U.S. citizen and therefore he is a derivative U.S. citizen, he thought he would be admitted on that basis. But the Board of Special Inquiry, which holds hearings to interrogate applicants, grilled him for 2 days and asked him a total of 119 questions. Questions like, has your native village ever been called by another name? Who lives in the first house of the 14th row from the head of the village? Did your school teacher ever stay overnight in the schoolhouse? Where is the village post office and who runs it? Where are your paternal grandparents buried and how are their graves marked? Who is your second brother and who are all the members in his family? What arrangements did your father make to prepare for your trip to America? And then, so these same questions were asked of Chin Yufeng's brother and father, and the inspectors compared their answers and found 20 discrepancies in their answers. So they denied him admittance and said because these discrepancies proved to them that these three people, the father, the brother, and the applicant, could not possibly be related if they couldn't answer these questions right. And what was most damaging was this one answer that the father gave. The father, when he was preparing to go back to China for a visit in 1920, you have to go through an interview process and you have to fill out a form so that you can come back and there'll be a record of your having permission to leave. But in any case, so in 1920, when Yufeng's father was going back to China, for some reason he said his wife died in 1920 when he was asked, are there any changes in your family? He said, my wife died in 1920. So they recalled that from his past testimonies, and they said, then how can Chen Yufeng be your son if he was born in 1923, if your wife died in 1920? So based on those discrepancies, on that major discrepancy, they were going to deport Chen Yufeng. So the family, and this, anyone who is denied admittance can, as I said, hire an attorney, appeal their case. You have a right to do that. But it means more expense because you have to hire an attorney, you have to pay the attorney to represent you. So in this case, the family did hire a very smart attorney who appeared before the Secretary of Labor, which is the next level of appeal, and argued point by point through all 20 discrepancies to say that these discrepancies were very inconsequential and, you know, irrelevant to really proving their relationship as a family. And for example, he said, as to this major discrepancy, there probably was a misunderstanding. Because after 1920, every other interview, interrogation of the father or any other member of the family, no one else said she had died. They all said she was still living. So there must have been a misunderstanding in 1920. And then the attorney said, and look at all the questions they answered correctly, like where's the post office and who's the postmaster? They have to be related to know those answers. So I've not seen this in any other file, so I think this attorney was really smart. And anyway, he did persuade the Secretary of Labor that the process had been unfair and that Chen Yufeng should be admitted, that they believed that he was the son. So after 2 months at Ellis Island, he is released and freed and admitted into the country 2 months. While for other Chinese immigrants who go through the appeal process, like at Angel Island, it usually takes at least 6 months to a year, sometimes 2 years if you go through the whole process of the district court, the circuit court, and the Supreme Court. And there were cases of people who did that. It would take a longer time. One woman that went through the whole process to the Supreme Court was detained at Angel Island for 20 months. And in the end, she was deported because the Supreme Court ruled against her. But in any case, I'm saying that at Ellis Island, because there were fewer Chinese cases, I think that the detention period as well as the appeal process was much shorter at Ellis Island than it was at Angel Island. So this is the certificate of identity that is issued to all the immigrants who are admitted into the country. This is the form it took between 1909 and 1940, and it's a certificate that proves that you are a legal immigrant. and it's a certificate you need to carry with you and to have available in case you get arrested or you question about your legality. And so here's the certificate of identity for Chen Yufan after he was admitted into the country. So as I said, because of this very difficult and cumbersome process for the Chinese, they made up 70% of the detention population at any time, because they were just there longer, even though they were fewer in numbers than the Japanese, for example. And during that time that they're detained at Angel Island, the Chinese were locked up in segregated quarters from women and from other racial ethnic groups. And these quarters were overcrowded, they were unsanitary, and they were unsafe, according to government inspectors. But there they were confined at all times, except three times a day. They would be released to go to the dining hall in the administration building for their meals. And then there, during the daytime hours, if it was not raining, there's a recreation yard, a small recreation yard that's fenced in that they could go to for exercise and to get some fresh air during the daytime hours. Otherwise, they just stay in the dormitory in these overcrowded conditions. And to prevent collusion on their interrogation, the Chinese and only the Chinese were not allowed to have any visitors until their case had been settled. In contrast, the living quarters for detainees at Ellis Island for the Chinese was less crowded and more pleasant. Although they did have the same kinds of restrictions applied, you know, they also were confined within the quarters, except during meal times, and they also were not allowed visitors. So the enforcement of the Chinese Exclusion Act applied at all ports of entry. According to the INS annual report for 1927, they described the quarters as being occupied, the quarters occupied by detained aliens consist of large, light, well-ventilated rooms with floors and dados of Dutch or white glazed tile. Each person is allotted a white enameled single bed with woven wire spring good quality mattress, pillow, blankets, and clean linen. Bathrooms have built-in porcelain tubs as well as showers. So you can see also by this picture, compared to the one I just showed you of Angel Island, that the living quarters were better at Ellis Island. Story of Law Shilo, who we interviewed, and she's one of the 20 people profiled in our book. She was the one that said it was like being in prison. By marrying Lo Gun, who was a US citizen, she was able to escape poverty in China and come to America in 1921. And she was detained at Angel Island for only 10 days. But she said she would never forget what happened to her there. And I'm going to read from her interview. She said, life at Angel Island was like being in prison. Every morning, we would all get up at 6 a.m. and they would let us out for meals and then lock us up again when we came back, the same at lunch and dinner time. It was the same food all the time, either bean sprouts or Chinese cabbage. The food was steamed to death, smelled bad, and tasted bad. They must have thought we were pigs. And a number of people we interviewed complained about the food and said it was like pig slop. There were at least three food riots that were instigated by the Chinese men in the dining hall, where soldiers from Fort McDowell on the island had to come with guns to quell the riots. But in the end, one of the food riots did lead to better food for the Chinese. This is a picture showing, I'm going to point out this person here in the back. That's Catherine Maurer. She is a Methodist deaconess, and she was assigned to Angel Island. She was there 5 days a week. From 1911 to 1952, she tended to the needs of all immigrants at Angel Island, men and women. The Chinese women that we interviewed said that they called her mama, mother, because she was so good to them. So Lau Shilo continued in her interview to say that there was nothing much to do. Once a week, a matron would take us out for a walk around the island, but I never went. Mostly we just sat there and waited out the day, staring out the window. We hardly ever chatted. No arguments, no jokes. Everyone was just worried about not being able to land. Later, when they told us that people had hanged themselves in the bathroom, we were afraid to go to the bathroom alone for fear of seeing ghosts. And everyone said, yes, we heard there were suicides. People were so driven to despair that they committed suicide, usually by hanging themselves in the bathrooms. But our research only showed 8 cases of suicide among Chinese at Angel Island. As far as Lau Shilo went, after she was released from Angel Island, she settled in San Francisco, Chinatown. Her husband worked in a restaurant, and she sewed at home, and later worked in the garment factories in Chinatown, and raised a family of 8 children. Her husband died in the 1950s, so she was widowed and single-handedly raised the children after that. She lived to be 97 years old. How did the conditions at Ellis Island compare to Angel Island? I found a number of oral histories that were done by the Ellis Island Oral History Project with Chinese who had been detained at Ellis Island, and one of them was Harry Liu. He was detained at Ellis Island for 2 months in 1951, and he was 15 years old at the time when he came by airplane, via Calcutta, London, Newfoundland, and then in Ellis Island. He was coming to join his father, who was a laundryman in New York, but his father was also a U.S. citizen, so he's coming claiming to be a son of a U.S. citizen. When he was interviewed by the Ellis Island Project, this is how he described life at Ellis Island. There had to be at least 200 Chinese, 95% from Hong Kong or Toisan, all speaking the same dialect. We slept in a room that had 50 guys in bunk beds, one on top of each other. We're never allowed outside. Always stay in the same room. Go to the dining hall. They feed us. We go back to our living quarters, or we hang out in the corridor area. We play chess. We play cards. Play ball. You know, try to kill time. That's all the pastimes we can have. Boring for 2 months. In fact, when I left Hong Kong, I was less than 100 pounds. When I got out of Ellis Island, I weighed 115. I gained 15 pounds. They fed us and nothing much to do. So the food was evidently better at Ellis Island than it was at Angel Island. So in this case, Harry went on to graduate from Fordham University, and he became a pharmacist, and he opened the Zhonghua Pharmacy on Mott Street in New York Chinatown. And this picture of him and his daughter at the pharmacy. Okay. So immigrant groups at Angel Island had different ways of dealing with their situation and any mistreatment. For the Chinese, they organized a group, the men did anyway, called the Jijiwei, which translates into self-governing association, sometimes called the Angel Island Liberty Association. And this organization started in 1916, and it was for mutual support. It was also to protest any kinds of discriminatory treatment on behalf of the Chinese detainees. This organization also maintained order in the barracks and collected membership fees so that they could buy recreational materials and equipment for the men, and they even started a school for the children at Angel Island. the Chinese children at Angel Island. So that was one way that they kind of came together and figured a way to resist any kind of discrimination. The second way, as I said, you know, they pulled together their resources and hired lawyers and helped each other on the interrogation as much as they can to pass the interrogation and to win their appeal cases. And the third way, which only the Chinese resorted to, was to write poems on the walls to express their anger and frustrations at their situation at Angel Island. And to date, about 200 poems have been discovered at Angel Island on the walls. And we have, as I said, included 135 of these in Chinese and English translation in our book. And all of these poems, and this is the, there are two floors to the immigration barracks, and there's poetry on both floors. Wherever the hand can reach on the walls, from the ceiling down to the bottom, rows and rows of calligraphy carved into the walls. And these poems were actually written by, when you think about it, Cantonese villagers who had at most probably just an elementary school education. There were some with secondary education and a few who had even gone to college before they immigrated. But the bulk of the Chinese men at this time had at least probably a primary school or elementary school education. And in those days, poetry was taught, classical poetry was taught as part of the curriculum. You learned to read and appreciate and write Chinese poetry. It was a common form of expression, medium of expression. So that's why that even though they had a very low education level, they could still write poems. And these poems followed the very strict classical forms of Chinese poems with four, six, or eight lines to a poem, even number, and five or seven characters per line. And there had to be a certain kind of rhythm to it. When I read you some of the poems, you'll hear the rhythm. And then every other line had to rhyme. And most of the poems of the 200, most of them met those requirements. The most outstanding poems among the ones we found are filled with historical legends and literary allusions and personal expressions of longing, of anguish, and of despair. They show remarkable talent, maturity, and wisdom beyond their years. And with very few exceptions, no one signed the poems. No one put their names at the end of the poem. And that was probably because they were fearful of retribution from the authorities, because there were signs on the walls that said, do not deface government property. Almost from the very beginning in 1910, when after the immigration station opened, the annual reports from Angel Island complained about the graffiti that they found on the walls. Written by the Chinese, and there were at least eight coats of paint ordered during the history of the immigration station there to cover up the graffiti. Regrettably, none of the poems written by the women have been recovered, as I said, because the administration building where they stayed had burnt down in 1940. So this poem was found in the lavatory on the first floor of the detention barracks. And it is the most deeply etched poem of all. And I should point this out, that the way this happened was initially the Chinese would just use a calligraphy brush and black ink and brushed a poem on the wall. And as immigration authorities kept painting over it, they decided, okay, we'll carve around the brush strokes so that we can form, and then we, you know, pull out the wood. So you have impressions of characters. So when you paint over them, you can still see the characters. Then they decided, the authorities said, okay, use putty and fill the impressions and then paint over it. So that's what they did. And so, in a way, that putty sealed the impressions. And through the years, the putty shrank, the painting, the last coat of paint peeled off, and you could see the characters very plainly as you do here. So I'm not sure if the poets knew what they were doing or this is just a stroke of fate. But in any case, this poem, it's in two stanzas, and I'm going to have Ava Chin help me with English, but in Cantonese, this is what it would sound. This is how it would be read. Mok ok kur lao ge sap tin, sa yan mak lai zi hin lin, ha sik ying hong mo yong mo, ji ting yam loi chak zhou bin, chong gam yin bi qi lao zhong, got wai hong guan zhong fun tong, mok do ke gan gai sai sik, Teet sing yok chai bin yu long.
Detained in this wooden house for several tens of days, it is all because of the Mexican exclusion law that implicates me. It's a pity heroes have no way of exercising their prowess. I can only await the word so that I can snap Zhu's whip. From now on, I am departing far from this building. All of my fellow villagers are rejoicing with me. Don't say that everything within is Western style. Even if it is built of jade, it is turned into a cage.
So Jew's whip refers to the general Judea in the 4th century. And he was credited with recovering the Yellow River Valley from outside invaders. And a fellow general who wanted to also be the first to recover the, to fight the enemy and to recover the lands, said that he always was fearful that he would not beat Judea to it, that Judea's whip would be ahead of him. So Jew's whip here refers to, means that always trying to, trying hard to be first and to claim the glory of a patriotic act. So for that second edition of Island, as I said, we did include poems from Ellis Island as well as from Victoria. And like many of the Angel Island poems, those poems adhere to the same strict form of regulated verse. And they bear a strong resemblance in content, in tone, and language to the Angel Island poems. And this actually should not come as a surprise when you think about it, because the poets and the Chinese immigrants at Ellis Island as well as at Victoria, BC, probably came from the same social economic background and from the same geographical region, Guangdong, in China. And all of them were given the same cold reception by immigration officers intent on enforcing Chinese exclusion laws at all three immigration stations. So together, this collection of poems that we pulled together in our book represents the first literary body of work by Chinese in North America, often haunting and poignant in their directness and simplicity of language. The poems express a vitality and a spirit of indomitability never before associated with Chinese America. They chronicle the indignity and trauma suffered at the hands of racist immigration systems while conveying what it was like to be Chinese, to be a Chinese immigrant imprisoned on an island. This poem, I should say that David Lai in 1977 found out that they were going to demolish the immigration station at Victoria, BC. And he went to the immigration station, copied down, he saw poems that were written on the walls of cells because the Chinese were actually locked up in individual cells at the Victoria immigration station. But he saw Chinese brush writing on the walls. He copied down many of the poems. And then when he was told to get out of the building, he cut off a piece of the wall with this one poem on it, which I'm going to read. And so this poem has a title, and it is written in 16 lines, 7 characters. It is what is called a wooden fish song, a mokyu, which were laments and folk songs that were sung by women in the villages of Guangdong who had been left behind by their husbands. So it's one, it's, I love this poem because it's one of the few we have from a women's perspective, although it's probably written by a man. And so in this poem, you know, she's telling the husband to be faithful, to be diligent, and to be frugal, and to come home. And so it's a very common message. So in Chinese, this is Chai Chuk Ting is the title. Chut Mun Kao Choi Wai Ga Kong Ba Jing Sam Tao Choi Lo Chung Lo Seung Ye Fa Quan Mok Choi Wai Ga Ji Yao Hai Chai No Lam Hang Ji Chuk Ting Tin Man Mok Chok No Yin Yi Go Fong Ga Chung Chai Yi Hai Mok Hua Kan Kim Yi Nin So Zhou Chung Chai Yi Yi Seung Mo Yakin Mai Ha So Loi Mo Bun Tong Ga Chung Gok Ok Se Mo Gan Ho Lan Lo La Sa Chun Lan Lim Fu Hai Sik Yat Do Chung Do Tam Do But Nim No No Lu Piu Piu Do Tak Chan Hing Loi Da Soi Mok Hok Mong Suk Dai Yan Gong sing lege hai toi san ge.
We are poor, so you're leaving home to seek wealth. Keep hold of propriety while on this journey. Never pick wildflowers along the road, for you have your own wife at home. Before you depart, I admonish you 1,000 times. Don't let my words just whistle past your ears. Don't worry about us. Be diligent and frugal. And 2 years hence, return to sweep the ancestors' tombs. Your wife and children haven't a thing to wear. Not half a cup of rice can be scooped from the pot. Our house and rooms are dilapidated. Our housewares are worn and the curtains torn. In the past, you did nothing but gamble. You never thought of me and my flowing tears. You are fortunate your elder brother has paid the taxes. Always remember your great debt to him.
I don't know if you caught this, but when she or he says, never pick wildflowers along the road, do you understand what that refers to? No one laughs, I guess you didn't. That means don't cohort with loose women while away from home. So then I'm going to read just a few poems from that were written at Angel Island. This one has 12 lines and 7 characters, poem number 7 in our book.
Bun yi gao sui loi mei zhao, yang fu bik zho dou cho chao, jik nui hui ngao long go yat, nai dap lam hang zhong tong zhao. Chan feng xiang long ya yu yat, hang dak ping an dai mei zhao, yi wai sou yat ho xiang fao, dien ji fu quan muk lou chao. Fan no ho doi, zhen nan sou. Gam chuk ga king lu xiang lou, dan yun zhou deng san fan si, min zai qi gan pui tim chao.
Originally, I had intended to come to America last year. Lack of money delayed me until early autumn. It was on the day that the weaver maiden met the cowherd that I took passage on the President Lincoln. I ate wind and tasted waves for more than 20 days. Fortunately, I arrived safely on the American continent. I thought I could land in a few days. How was I to know I would become a prisoner suffering in the wooden building? The barbarian's abuse is really difficult to take. When my family's circumstances stir my emotions, a double stream of tears flows. I only wish I could land in San Francisco soon, thus sparing me this additional sorrow here.
And this is poem 24 from Angel Island. 6 lines, 7 characters. It has a title as well as a signature. Sam yang o gam, ye jing me mun fong siu sing, ying ying song ting gin ging wing. Wan mo san san yang um teen, chong sing chick chick yut me ming. Bei fu sung lin teen sung hin, chow yen tok cho yi chung bin, toi san sing yu.
In the quiet of night, I heard faintly the whistling of wind. The forms and shadows saddened me. Upon seeing the landscape, I composed a poem. The floating clouds, the fog darken the sky. The moon shines faintly as the insects chirp. Grief and bitterness entwined are heaven sent. The sad person sits alone, leaning by a window.
I want to read 2 poems from Ellis Island, but I want to show you where the poems were found. They were found in this building called the Baggage and Dormitory Building, where detainees were kept on the 3rd floor. And the Chinese poems were found in the bathroom or the lavatory, etched on the marble dividers of the stalls. There were about 7 poems and some other inscriptions and graphic images on the walls, and we have translated 4 poems in our book. Oops, lost my place. Sorry. So this is poem one in our book from Ellis Island. It has 14 lines, 7 characters. Similar themes of missing home, of the harsh laws, referring to the Chinese Exclusion Act, and about war in China, concerned about what was going on in China at the time, and many similar uses of colloquial terms in this poem, like referring to the United States as the flowery flag. That's what the immigrants called the United States, because of our flag being so colorful and stars. And so they see it as being a flowery flag. That's how they refer to U.S. Another term that's used in the Angel Island poems, as well as in the Ellis Island poems, that were actually, when you think about it, signs of resistance and criticism of their mistreatment and the harsh laws. Instead of using Chinese Exclusion Act, they would refer to these laws as being cruel laws. And instead of saying detention, they would actually use the term arrested and detained. And they would never refer to the immigration station as Angel Island Immigration Station. They called it the wooden house or the prison. So those kinds of colloquial terms as well as phrases are repeated in these poems as well. So this one is, Si nim gu heng an lu lau, ba zi ha yin ha mo yao, fu mo bak suk chai yu san. Lao Fong Ok Yu Bin Sing Kao Ming Dai Yu Tin Fa Ki Do Yi Wai On Ning Ha Mo Sao Su Ji Yin Man Jiang O Bo But Yao Fan Shu Yan Ku Lao Ha Nang Gai Kut Ha Tiu Lai Dai Ki Sing Li Ha Zi Yao Yik Mong Tong Guan Chai Hap Lik 捐诸回国，杀我仇。得见父母，妻儿媒，笑口吟吟，讲西游。
Thinking of home, my tears begin to flow. I wonder when can I ever be free of worry? Parents, uncles, wives, and children scattered, our houses and rooms completely leveled. Luckily, I landed in the flowery flag, thinking I would be safe and free of sadness. Who knew that I'd be seized by immigration officials? They threw me in detention, ignoring my protests. How can I gain relief from these oppressive laws? I await the time of our victory, for then we can be free. I hope compatriots will join together, pool their strength, donate funds, and return home to kill our enemies. Then, when I'm reunited with my parents, wife, and children, with laughter, I'll describe my journey to the West.
There was one major difference in the backgrounds of Chinese detainees at Angel Island versus Ellis Island, and that was there is a large population of Chinese seamen or sailors at Ellis Island. They had been arrested for jumping ship or deserting their ships, and they were waiting for deportation at Ellis Island. And there were raids that were conducted by INS of the Chinatown communities trying to find these illegal immigrants, these seamen who had jumped ship. We know that from newspaper accounts, there were 206 Chinese sailors who were arrested and detained at Ellis Island in 1925 and at one time. And then in 1943, there were 300 reported detained at Angel Island. Now, most of them were poor, uneducated, and from Guangdong province, but also some came from Fujian, Shanghai, and Hainan Island as well. So the second poem, which is a quatrain, a four-line poem, was most likely written by one of these Chinese sailors. Cheng gam fu quan. Yeah, cheng cheng gam fu quan sao ming cheng. Hui xun hong yao san sao xiang. Huan guan mo pa yi men lei. Ding yao an yin.
Though imprisonment is bitter, my life will be long. If I return to the ship, I fear bodily harm. I urge you, don't be afraid of immigration laws. It's certain we'll be free to go home in peace.
Okay. So in 1940, as I said, a fire destroyed the administration building, and the immigration station was moved back to the mainland, to San Francisco. And the site became a California state park, part of the system then in 1963, and the remaining buildings were slated for demolition. Fortunately, this park ranger I mentioned, Alexander Weiss there, he passed away earlier this year, but he was making his rounds, and he was looking into the empty barracks where the Chinese men were kept, and he saw the Chinese writing on the walls. And even though he didn't know how to read Chinese, he understood that they were probably of historical significance, and that it was probably poetry and not just graffiti. Anyway, this, against the wishes of his superiors, he called attention to it in the Asian American community. And because of his awareness and willingness to encourage the community to pay attention to these poems and to preserve it and to save it, he also told the community that the buildings are going to be destroyed, the poems are going to be gone. So we better do something about it quick. So for the next 40 years after the discovery of the poems, Community activists and descendants of Angel Island detainees worked very hard to save the poetry and to save the site. And in 1998, they successfully lobbied for National Historic Landmark status for the immigration site, which then means that it will not be destroyed. And then they embarked on a massive preservation project to call attention to Angel Island as a symbol of America's history of racial exclusion and as a site of conscience and reconciliation for the nation. In 1943, the Chinese Exclusion Act was finally repealed as a goodwill gesture to China, which was an ally to the US in World War II. And as a result, Chinese were given the right to become naturalized US citizens, but only 105 Chinese per year was allowed from China based on the 1924 National Quota Act. 105 Chinese per year. So it's not until 1965, when Congress passed the 1965 Act, Immigration Act, that the last vestige of racism was removed from our immigration laws and every country was put on an equal basis. Thousands, about thousands of Chinese immigrants were able to come to this country based on a preference system of family reunification, or if they had certain high skills or professional skills to contribute, then they don't even need a sponsor to come to this country. And if you were related to a U.S. citizen, you don't even count as part of your nation's quota. So every country was given a max of 20,000, but in actuality, more than 20,000 Chinese came to this country after the 65 Act. And so as a result, the population of Chinese in this country grew from 500,000 in 1970 to 4 million in 2010. Many families have been separated because of the exclusion laws were reunited. And the broken immigration system was finally fixed. And yet today, 50 years later, we are faced again with a broken immigration system. We have 11 million undocumented immigrants living in the shadows of society, similar to the Chinese in the exclusion era, and more attempting to cross our borders every day. 400,000 immigrants per year are detained in government-run or private-run detention centers for long periods of time and in worse conditions than at Angel Island. And there is a long wait for applicants trying to rejoin family members here in the United States or to get one of the work visas to fill the high-skilled jobs. So I think as we search for a way to fix this broken immigration system, we would do well to heed the lessons of Angel Island and Ellis Island, and that is to remember what can go wrong when our immigration policies do not live up to our ideals of liberty and justice for all. So let us not allow history to repeat itself. If we are to maintain our lead in the global economy, while remaining true to our values as a nation of immigrants, we need to construct a new immigration system that is equitable, workable for the 21st century. Thank you for your kind attention. Questions? Can I, we have time? Can I take any questions from anybody? Yes. Yeah, in the front. Yeah.
I'm curious about what your favorite poem is and why. Having worked with 100.
Actually, my favorite one is the one that was deeply etched in two stanzas. I think because one, it's the most visible in that beautiful Chinese calligraphy, although there are many other poems, but not as visible as that one. And the sentiments that are expressed in there, even if it is made of jade, it's turned into a cage.
And also the first stanza talks about, you know, that because of the Mexican exclusion laws. So it reminds us too that Mexico had a Chinese Exclusion Act too in the 1930s. And many Chinese Mexicans were driven out of Mexico. And when they crossed the border into the United States, they were arrested by our immigration officials and kept at Angel Island until a boat, their ships arrived to take them back to China. So this person who wrote those two stanzas is someone who is waiting to be deported and is leaving his words of consolation to those behind him. I have many other favorites, but that I would say that one was definitely one of my favorites. Yes?
I was curious if you had an idea between 1910 and 1940 about how many Chinese businessmen and people in the world had come.
Okay, so the 100,000 Chinese who came to Angel Island between 1910 and 1940, what they call merchants, those claiming to be merchants or to be family members of merchants, I would say probably 30%. Many more claim to be family members of U.S. citizens. I would say 40%. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And actually, those statistics do exist in Erica Lee's book, At America's Gates. She actually has it broken down by status as to how people were coming, what status they were using to come, and merchants was one of the status. And so there are specific numbers in her book, At America's Gates. Yes. Any other questions? Yes.
I was curious about the process you guys chose when you were translating these poems.
Mm-hmm.
What was priority or what you want to preserve?
We wanted to go for content and historical accuracy, first of all. We gave up trying to make things rhyme. It would be impossible. Himark Lai had the best mastery of Chinese among the three of us. All three of us are American born, but he went through Chinese school, but he also self-taught and knew how to read classical Chinese. So what we did was that Himark would translate the poems into English, by content, by meaning, and not worry about, you know, the rhythm and the imageries and whatnot. And then he also wrote all the footnotes, the annotations, to explain like Sue's whip and what that means, or what does flowery flag mean in the context. And then Jenny, who's the poet among the three of us, would then refine Himark's Chinese English translation of those poems, and then double check with Himark to make sure she didn't change any of the meanings in the process. So it's poetic sounding in English because of Jenny, but it's the translation itself is close because of Himark's bilingual abilities. So we made this conscientious effort to go for content over form. And then to make sure that we had adequate footnotes to really explain some of these terms and meanings that we can't in the translation easily. Yes?
You had mentioned that in the first edition of the book that there were some poems that were in the main section of the book and the others were footnotes or in the appendix?
In the appendix section, right.
So and then they're brought together. Why some separated from the other?
Yeah, it was Himark's decision, and I asked him, why did you do that? And he said it was to conserve space, because the poems in the appendix is in smaller type. But also, he thought that the 69 poems in the main text were the better poems, and the poems in the appendix were not as well written. but I would, you read, you, well, we combine them, but if you ever look at the first edition, some people say to me that, no, those poems in the back are pretty good too. But that was his decision, and those were the two reasons he used. And then he said, well, you know, he thought about it, and he said, you know, in the next edition, yeah, we shouldn't do that. We should just put them all together. And we arranged the poems by five categories, like the voyage, detention, the weak shall conquer, the barbarians, parting words. So we took all 135 poems and renumbered them. So now everyone's mad at us at Angel Island because the docents have learned where the poems are on the wall by the numbers in our first edition. So I said, okay, you guys are going to have to renumber all the poems when you do your tour. But in any case, so that's the main change, and those are the reasons why for the second edition. Yes?
Have you ever had anyone come forward to claim authorship of any of the poems?
We kept asking people who were detained there, first of all, do you remember seeing the poems on the walls? And they all said yes. And we said, did you write any of the poems? Did you see anyone write any of the poems? Do you know who wrote these poems? And everyone said no. But in the new book, in the second edition, I did find someone who claimed ownership of one of the poems. Henry Wong in Salinas, California. He went to Angel Island in the 1980s, a return visit. He had been detained there in 1926 for 2 months. And when he went to visit, he told the docent at Angel Island that, I wrote a poem on the wall with a fountain pen, and this is the spot he pointed out, the room and the corner where he wrote the poem. But of course, since he did it with a fountain pen, you can't see it. I mean, it was painted over long ago. So, but when he went home, he wrote that poem. He remembered that poem. He wrote the poem in beautiful Chinese calligraphy. He's a good calligrapher. And he explained that he was 16 years old at the time. He wrote this poem on the wall in this spot. And so I actually included his story as one of the 20 profiles. And he translated the poem too. So he sent it to us in both Chinese as well as his translation. It's in four lines, and I don't have it here to read to you, but it's in our book. And so he claimed ownership. He's the only one that stepped forward and claimed ownership so far. And there's one guy, Li Dongbo, he actually signed his name to three poems. And we noted that in our collection, the second edition. And he's the only one that did that. And then the Liberty Association, the TTUI, they also signed two poems as an organization. But other than that, sometimes you'll see a surname and where they're from, Toi San, and that's about the extent of his signature. Okay, yes.
Given the existence of the poems, but the way in which there doesn't seem to be much tracking or tradition about the poems went to people, like, is there, like in any of the family associations in San Francisco or anywhere else, any kind of oral tradition that's capturing people's, has talked about the fact that they saw the poems on the walls?
Only in the oral histories that we did. Because until we started doing research and asking to interview people, no one else had written about Angel Island or about the poems. So it started with our research project and the family associations. I mean, there is kind of like a complicity of silence in the community to not talk about immigration, not talk about Angel Island. I mean, everyone in the community knew that we all had dual surnames, that we were all paper sons and paper daughters or descendants of. And they all knew what our real surnames are, but you know, we were always told, you know, on our birth certificates and at school and with any white authorities, you know, never admit to what your real surnames are. But within the community, you know, you belong to the correct family association with the correct surname. So our family belonged to the Tom Family Association and the Zhongshan Association, which is the district from which my parents came. And everyone in the community knew that we were Toms and that we were from Zhongshan.
but the complicity is that the whole community knew that everyone could get in trouble, or you could get someone else in trouble if you, you know, divulged that they were paper sons or paper daughters. So no one ever talked about it. So no one would record this. No one would write about the poems or write about what happened at Angel Island. They would rather forget to begin with. Yes.
So this silence would not only be laterally across the community, but also vertically within the family.
Yes. I mean, I'm a typical example. We all knew that we had, we didn't understand maybe, but we all knew we had, there's a reason, and it's because we were illegal. We understood that we were illegal. You know, there was a confession program that the INS started in 1955 to 1965. It was like an amnesty program, but not quite. Anyone could step forward, and if they would admit to have come in as a paper son or fraudulently, being illegal, INS, if you had no criminal record, would adjust your status and give you back your name, your real name, and give you permanent residency, and you could become a U.S. citizen and clear your name. And about 30,000 Chinese did accept that opportunity, and many of them because they wanted to sponsor their real family members from China, and also they wanted to get their name back and to, you know, kind of clear the deck. My father never believed that immigration would not deport him if he said he was a paper son. My father was a paper son. And to the day he died, he, you know, always told us not to tell anyone what our real surnames are. And on his gravestone, you'll see in Chinese his real name, Tom Yip Ching. And in English, it would say Yang Hing Sun, his paper name. So he took it to his grave. And there are many others who felt that way. And there were many people in the community who didn't want to get other family members in trouble. If they confess, then immigration, one of the ways they would do it is they would decide, okay, who's your paper family then? And then they'll be able to incriminate other members of the system. So it was a very controversial thing, and not all Chinese American Chinese families stepped forward and confessed and cleared their names. Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to listen a little bit about the design of the oral history part, which is the fascinating. During the period of the confession law, and then a lot of families confess, but a lot of them because they understand legal paper. For example, like my friend or my client, I'm a genealogist, and the only one that I'm working on helping him with writing his biographical family history book of his grandfather, and it's also part of the paper son, because his father and mother is actually on the same immigration paper from the grandpa, and so they can never get married, so they end up soon, and then never be able to justify his real last name. And then after the history recurs, and then this is actually during this period, a lot of people sign, people voted during that period, and now they are reaching the age of retirement. They are starting to dig into their roots in the family history. And that's part of that that I'm doing this.
It's a very complicated research project to kind of straighten things out, because even when you can go to the National Archives and get the immigration case file and the transcript of the interrogation, how do you know whether this person isn't lying throughout the whole interrogation because he or she is a paper son or a paper daughter? And because family relationships are so convoluted, I think in William Wong's case, his mother came as their aunt, and then later had to divorce and remarry, right?
They were sister and brother on the same paper.
Oh, okay, so,
yeah. His father arranged for a village friend to become the husband of his wife, but they never married. So
she came as the wife of this friend, yeah. Village, yeah.
Confession, they are afraid being detained, so they cannot confess for the fact. So then for the wife, the mother and father never married.
Mm-hmm.
And and the mother, then the kids, the four kids that they brought up and born in America, is the father is under the different last name, not the father's last name.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I was wondering, I can't remember whether you talked about it in the book. Now, all the people wanted to write poems or had something to say, some of them may not have had that many skills. Did they ever utilize their friends to help them write, you know, like tell them what they how they felt, have someone else write a poem for them? Or did everyone basically wrote a poem and they write it?
I think that the poets of the men wrote their own poems, but we believe that the calligrapher is a different person. And that, so they would compose the poem, but the calligrapher would be the one to carve it. That's why the writing that I showed of that poem, it is really block print calligraphy style, very beautiful calligraphy, and it, almost all the poems is in that penmanship. So we think that there were certain people who were good calligraphers who did the carving, the writing and the carving. But the composition, I think, comes from the men or the individual men themselves. In fact, there's one poem that's upstairs, and it was carved in reverse. You can only read the poem if you put a mirror to it. And I think this calligrapher was showing off his ability and talents. The other possibility is maybe he thought people can make a rubbing and take the poem with them and they leave Angel Island. So we think that there are two people working on the poems, one composed and then one who actually did the carving. Yeah. Yes?
In general, how much does it cost for a trip to come over? Also, how many percentage of people actually maybe come outside the system altogether?
Well, we think 80 to 90% came outside the system as fraudulent or illegal immigrants or paper sons and paper daughters. The going rate in 1920, I know because that's when my father came, you buy the identity papers and your passage and everything. It costs $100 per year on your paper. So my father came as a 17-year-old young man. And so his everything cost him $1,700. That's a lot of money in 1921. And in most cases, people borrowed the money, and they had to, when they arrived, like my father did, work and pay back. My father, it took him about 10 years to pay back the debt to his uncles who had forwarded the money. So that's about the going rate. And that would include your passage money, the money for the ship ticket. And a guarantee that if you fail the interrogation and are denied entry, you would have a return passage free. That's included in the total figure. And actually the ships were responsible for taking you back if you were deported, because they shouldn't have brought you to begin with if you had any kinds of contagious diseases, or if you, according to the immigration laws, should not have, couldn't have been admitted. They should know this. And so actually the ship companies subjected all of their passengers to a physical exam for hookworm and trachoma before they'll sell them a ticket. So immigration had this thing with the ship companies. But in any case, that amount that my father paid would include, if he had failed and had to go back to China, he would have free passage back. But he still would have that debt, right, when he goes back to China. So that's why people said, people hung themselves rather than go back or jump ship on the way back, because they would be ashamed of having failed in their goal, but also that they would be facing more debts when they go back to go back home, empty-handed. Yeah. Yes, Russell.
What do you mean by people are here to buy your book?
Oh, right. We had a great turnout yesterday, and we sold out on our books at Mocha. But I really encourage you to get a copy of my book. Go to Amazon.com or any of it's selling at all the online outlets. And if you go to Amazon, you can get free shipping. And they're selling it at discount as it is. The book is twice as long as the first edition, and it's $5. It's only $5 more than the first edition. So it's a good buy. Okay.
Hi, one.
Yeah, what last question?
Seattle was also a major immigration.
Yes.
For the Chinese, were there similar homes or?
Yes.
In Seattle.
The probably the experience and the people there are the same. Angel Island had 100,000 Chinese come through. Seattle's the second busiest. It had 40,000. And then Hawaii, Honolulu, had 20,000. And then Ellis Island had 5,000. So you can see the comparison. So yes, so Seattle's a major hub. There were two immigration stations in Seattle. And I asked the Wing Luke Museum people if anyone had found Chinese writing or poetry at the building that still stands in Seattle, and they said they didn't find any Chinese writings or poems as we did at the other Ellis Island or Angel Island, and they just recently that building still stands in Seattle, and it's been converted into a artist colony, and they have studio space for artists, but they have also put historical markers to designate what areas of the building was used by the immigration officials for what purpose. And there, all the immigration case files for the Chinese cases in Seattle are at the Seattle National Archives. Yeah, but they would all have been subjected to similar detention as well as interrogation, the same process, because they're still enforcing the Chinese Exclusion Act in Seattle. And I bet people did write poems, we just, no one has recovered them at Seattle.
Okay.
Thank you.